Please join me in the call to worship. Let the righteous be joyful. Let them exult before God. Let them be jubilant with joy. We ascribe you all power and majesty, O God, and sing you your praises. Awesome is God in the sanctuary, the same God of Israel who gives power and strength to the people. We ascribe you all power and majesty, O God, and sing you our praises. Let us worship God. Let us pray. We sing praises to you, O God. We raise a psalm in your honor. You clothe us in all goodness. We are draped in accordance with your design. As you have sent Jesus Christ to make your will known, you promise your Holy Spirit to guide us along your path. As your holiness fills our halls, hear us as we worship your name. Amen.
I
Please join me in the Litany of Assurance. Rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may be glad when Christ's glory is revealed. To God be the dominion forever and ever. Humble yourselves under God's mighty hand, that in due time God may exalt you. To God be the dominion forever and ever. Cast all your anxieties on God, for God cares about you. To God be the dominion forever and ever. Be sober, be watchful. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around seeking someone to devour. To God be dominion forever and ever. The peace of God be with you.
And also you.
Greet one another in peace.
Well, good morning. We'd like to welcome the children back. Come on up. Come on up. You guys might remember a couple of weeks ago, right before Mark and I went on vacation, we had six people join this church, six young people. More coming? Well, Mark and I last week attended a church where my son goes to church in Colorado. And it was this great, big, huge church. Huge church. It had 5,000 members. We got there and they had people with lights telling us where to park, and they had police crossing us at the street, and they had big screens up on their walls, and it was this super fancy, nice church. 5,000 members, three services, just amazing. But you know what struck me as interesting was they announced how many young people they had taken into their church on Confirmation Sunday. 5,000 members took in 25 children. We're a church of 250 members, and we took in six. I think this church has a lot to be proud of you young people, and the fact that you come to Sunday school, and that your parents are raising you in the faith, so when your turn to join the church comes, we'll be able to add you to our numbers. And I say that because six seems like such a small number, and we worry about numbers so often, but it's not the number, it's the faith that the six people who joined brought. So this summer, I see you're all here, we're gonna have summer Sunday school. And for the next 6 weeks, I'm gonna be teaching you some lessons on how God wants us to live and the kind of people God wants us to be using a curriculum written by the Robertson family. Now, who's the Robertson family? Does anybody know? Who's the Robertson family? Who? Do you know who that is? Well, the Robertson family are the Duck Dynasty family. How many of you have heard of Duck Dynasty? I thought so. We have a 5 or 6 week curriculum written by the Duck Dynasty people called Faith Commander. And today we're gonna do a lesson called Redonkulous Faith. And we're gonna talk about what that means to have a faith that is redonkulous for God. So I invite you all to set your schedules, plan to be here this week and another 5 weeks, because we have a lot of really exciting things going on. And then after that, we're gonna start a new series of something else. So I want to encourage you to set your calendars and plan to be here, because we've got some cool stuff happening in Sunday school. Let us pray. God, we thank you that as the year continues, we have this opportunity to share your faith with our young people. We ask, Lord, that they are faithful in coming and that their hearts be open to learning these redonkulous lessons for you. Amen. I'd like to invite you to Sunday school. We're going to be in Mrs. Crawford's old room. You know where Mrs. Crawford is? Come on down.
Please be seated. First scripture text today comes from Acts chapter 1, starting at verse 6. So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom of Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. When they entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter, John, and James, and Andrew, Philip, and Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. Our second New Testament lesson today comes from 1 Peter chapter 4. We'll read a couple verses and then jump down to chapter 6. "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's suffering, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of God, which is the Spirit of the Holy Spirit, is rests upon you." Our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 17, starting at verse 1. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people, to give glory and eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from this world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave me, I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you have given me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one." Pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It is great to go on vacation, but at a certain point, it's always great to get back to home. We went out there, of course, to see our son Daniel's graduation, and he did do that. In 4 years, he graduated with a degree in mechanical engineering and minors in math and aerospace, and he did it all while graduating magna cum laude. And he almost graduated summa, which is a 3.9 and above. Now, I tell you this not just because I'm a proud parent, but it makes me feel smart by association, as if somehow his intellectual accomplishments reflect on me. I know in reality they don't, but it still makes me feel smart by association. Now, I said he graduated magna cum laude. That's actually not correct, because the engineering programs don't use the same designations as all the other schools. Engineering programs usually only have two honors. One is honors, and then high honors or special honors, they call it. Now, why did they do this? Well, first of all, their thinking is that they don't expect even their good students to get a 3.9 or above throughout their course of study. And so their highest honors is just 3.8 and above. And so, of course, Daniel graduated with that. And as I was watching the ceremony, I wondered, okay, that's good, I understand that. They don't expect the GPAs to be as high in those programs, but why can't they still use the same titles but slightly different GPAs? Summa could simply be then 3.8 and above. Isn't that the way in life? When you look around, there's already somebody or some group doing something different so that we all can't agree. We all can't come together. We all can't be one. We see it in our society. We see it in our churches. You go to one church and you recite the Lord's Prayer, and it's, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." We say, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." And yet other churches, it's, "Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sinned against us." We all worship the same God. We all claim the same Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We all have English as the primary language, and yet we cannot translate that part of the Lord's Prayer together so that we can be one. Everywhere you look around, there's somebody or some group doing something different, so we can't all agree. We can't all be together. We can't all be one. In all the fields of study, human beings are a rather interesting breed. If you look around at all the areas of study, they try to figure out why human beings are the way we are. Even in the hard sciences, where we're considered to be millions of years of evolution among primates and billions of years of evolution on planet Earth, there's still some very troubling questions. Why are we so different than other animals? In many biological ways, we are very similar, but not our minds. Our minds are not just a quantitative difference with other animals. In other words, you can't just add a few IQ points to a mouse and you end up with a human being's brain. It's not just a quantitative difference, but there's an actual qualitative difference of how our minds work and how all the other animals on this earth minds work. And so science is constantly trying to figure out, how did this come about and why is this? Of course, in the arts and in literature and the humanities, since the very beginning of civilization and writing, people have wondered about human beings. Why are we here? What is our purpose? John Lennon, in his song Imagine, talks about there, imagine there's no heaven and there's nothing to fight or die for. And at the end of the song, he says, and that we can all live as one. It's kind of always haunted me that he saw a vision of oneness and yet didn't seem to understand where that came from. In our gospel lesson today, Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he's about to go to the cross and die for the sins of the world. And while he's in the Garden of Gethsemane, he is talking to his Father, and he is asking his Father for what he can get out of this deal. Okay, I'm going to go to the cross and I'm going to die for the sins of the world, but this is what I want out of it. And what does he ask for his end of the deal? He asks that we be one. That we be one, just as he is in the Father and the Father is in him, that we be in one, not just with each other, but also with God. In Jesus' last minutes in the garden, where he's asking the Father for what he wants out of this whole deal of going to the cross and dying, he says, "I want them all to be one, just as I am in you and you are in me." That is the answer to all the questions that have been asked since the very first time someone asked a question about what humanity was all about. We exist. We human beings exist in this world. We were brought into beginning in the creation to exist so that we could be one, one with each other and one with God. Well, what does that mean? That sounds all nice and good, but what does that actually mean? At the end of the graduation ceremony, when the graduation was done and they announced all the names, we of course had to get out of our seats. Now, this graduation took place in an indoor stadium, and it was actually the place where the Colorado College plays its hockey. Probably know a little about that because the Lakers, I've heard, have played them in the past. Now, he didn't graduate from Colorado College, but that's the venue they were using for their graduation. Now, this venue has very steep rows of seats. It's not something that slants back gently. It goes up pretty steep. And as you're sitting up there, if you have any fear of heights, you don't feel very good when you're in the top row. Well, after the graduation was done and people started filing out, I saw a mother and her daughter, and they were going down the stairs. Now, this daughter was probably 5 or 6 years old, and you could tell from the way she was walking down, she wasn't too sure about being up at those heights. And so she had one hand on the railing, and on the other hand, her left hand, she had it on her mom's back. And it was amazing to watch them because they moved as one. As the mother stepped, so did the daughter. And as exactly where the mother was going, that's exactly where the daughter was going. So they were going in the same direction. They were going at the same pace. And there was an intimacy between them because there was this touch that was being shared between them all the way down. I think that's a good way to think about the oneness that God wants for us. It is a oneness where we're going in the same direction as God is. We're working cooperatively with God. We're doing the things that God wants, not only what God wants, but also what we want, but it's the same thing. And we're also going at the same pace. Instead of trying to rush ahead of what God wants to do in life or to be slow in doing what God wants to do in life, we're on the same pace as God, going at the same speed. And there is this intimacy between us and God, the intimacy of a contact between a parent and a child. I think that's a good way to think of the kind of oneness that God wants for us, not only with God, but also one another. In our gospel lesson, Jesus tells us very clearly what the purpose, what the meaning of life is, what it's all about, and that's for us to be one. In our New Testament lesson from Acts, we hear about the story of Jesus going up into heaven. Now, after he had been around for 40 days after his resurrection, after he presented himself as visible proof that he had raised from the dead in the flesh to hundreds of people, we are told, then it came time for him to ascend into heaven. Now, when I went to seminary, it was interesting because there was some questions that people liked to ask. And one of them that they constantly asked while I was there was, if Jesus came back today, would you recognize him? And along that vein, if Jesus came back today, are you doing the things that he would want you to do? I understand what these questions meant and where they were headed, but I don't know where this idea came about that we don't know how Jesus is going to come back or in what form or what way. It's right there in our lesson from Acts. As Jesus was ascending into heaven in the front of hundreds of those individuals who were witnesses on that mount, the angels told them, "Why are you standing looking up at heaven? Because this Jesus you've seen go into heaven is going to return in the very same way." In other words, when he comes back, everyone is going to be a witness to that who is on the earth. Everyone. And you think, well, how in the world can that happen? Well, first off, with modern technology, media technology, we can come a lot closer to that than certainly you could in Jesus' day, because billions of people around the world can be witnessing the same event, a live event. But as good as modern media is, still, with different work schedules and different time zones and different channels, not everybody's going to be on the same channel, or not everybody's going to be watching TV, or not everybody's going to be awake at the same time. So there's still fundamental problems, even with our mass media today. So how in the world is Jesus Christ going to come and manifest himself to everybody at the same time? It's actually pretty easy, because it has to do with the infinite nature of God. The reason we are not overwhelmed and, in fact, swamped with the presence of God right now, in our minds, in our hearts, in our bodies, in our souls, the reason we're not swamped now is because God has pulled back so that we can have a choice, so that we can choose to believe or choose not to believe, so that we can choose to serve God or not serve God. We can choose what we are going to honor and worship and serve in this world. God has pulled back. Not to be away from us, but so that we can make a choice. But what Scripture tells us is when Jesus comes back on that day, the infinite nature of God is no longer going to be a question for faith or for study. It is going to be apparent to everyone. And in that day, the presence of God will swamp everyone's minds and hearts and souls. And it's talked about in Scripture as piercing us to the very depths of our soul. Now, we see what this looks like a little bit in Scripture already. If you read some of the encounters the prophets had with God, they talk about a fire inside of them that they are afraid is going to consume them, or a fire inside of them that burns so that they cannot do anything but obey God. We already have glimpses of what that's going to be like when Jesus returns. But the reason everyone on earth and in heaven and anywhere else anyone is going to see Jesus is because he's going to manifest himself in the infinite nature of God. No longer will there be a questions about who Jesus is. No longer will there be the questions about, is he the Messiah? No longer will there be questions about, is he God or just a prophet or just a good man, a holy man, a teacher? In that day, the infinite nature of God will be revealed to everyone in a twinkling of an eye. And what's more, for those of us who have believed, for those of us who have tried to worship him, for those of us who have tried to serve him, for those of us who have tried to do our best in following the teachings that he has left us, that is going to be a day when we will experience that oneness. Oneness with each other, oneness with God, where we are going in the same direction with God, we are going at the same pace and speed as God, and we have that intimacy with God, that intimacy that touch conveys right here and right now in our world. And it'll be a wonderful day indeed. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for coming and being born among us and ministering to us and dying for us and raising from the dead for us so that we may know that oneness for which we were called into being. In your holy name we pray. Amen. We do have the joy today of baptism, and so I would like to ask Piper Rose and Claudia Morgan to please come forward with their parents, and also Audrey.
Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always to the close of the age. Obeying the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and sure of his presence with us, we baptize those whom he has called to be his own. In Jesus Christ, God has promised to forgive our sins and has joined us together in the family of faith, which is his church. God has delivered us from darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. In Jesus Christ, God has promised to be our Father and to welcome us as brothers and sisters of Christ. Know that the promises of God are for you, By baptism, God puts his sign on you to show that you belong to him and gives you Holy Spirit as a guarantee that, sharing Christ's reconciling work, you will also share his victory, that dying with Christ to sin, you'll be raised with him to new life.
On behalf of the session, I present Piper Rose Bernier and Claudia Morgan Bernier, daughters of Paul Bernier and Tabitha McMillan Bernier.
Now we have some questions of the parents. Do you publicly confess your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? If so, answer, I do. Do you promise in dependence on the grace of God to bring up your child in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord? If so, answer, I do. Will you be a faithful member of the congregation, giving yourself in every way, and will you seek the fellowship of the church wherever you may be? If so, answer, we will.
Our Lord Jesus Christ ordered us to teach those who are baptized. Do you, the people of this church, promise to tell the child the good news of the gospel, to help them know all that Christ commands, and by your fellowship, strengthen their family ties with the household of God? If so, please answer, we do.
Let us pray. By the power of your Spirit, bless this water, that it may be a fountain of deliverance, raise Piper and Claudia to new life, and graft them to the body of Christ. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon Piper and Claudia, that they may have power to do your will, and continue forever in the risen life of Christ, to whom, with the Father and the Holy Spirit, be all glory and honor, now and forever. Amen.
Would you please join in the congregational prayer found in your bulletin? Let us pray. Holy God, remind us of the promises given in our own baptism and renew our trust in you. Make us strong to obey your will and to serve you with joy for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Now let us stand and say what we believe. Reciting the Apostles' Creed found in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Are there any announcements that anyone has at this time? Any prayer requests?
I've got one, Mark.
Yes.
For Bert Jones, is going to have surgery on Friday.
Yep.
He's been pretty much homebound for the last few weeks. He's had bad back.
Bad back, yeah. Anyone else? Okay. Let's gather together as God's people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we are thankful that we can come before you because of what you've done for us at any time, that you will always hear us, that you will always listen to us, and that you're always trying to do what's best for us, even if we can't see it, even if we don't understand it. We thank you for this mercy and this grace that you have given us. We thank you that you have claimed us in our baptisms and through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord God, a special prayer of thanks on this day as we remember the purpose for which you brought us into existence, to be one with you and to be one with each other. We thank you, Lord God, for the glimpses we get of this oneness in family and relationships here and now. And we thank you that what you are going to bring to us is even greater than these. We thank you, Lord God, for this destiny that you have given to each and every one of us. We'd also like to pray this day, Lord God, for those who are going through difficulties, troubles, trials. We pray specifically for Bert and for all others who need your help. And now let us take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. Lord God, thank you for hearing our prayers for others. Now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us using debts and debtors, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please join me in the prayer of dedication found in your bulletin. You pour out your love upon us, O God. You give us eternal life. As your mercy is made manifest in Jesus, may thanksgiving be shown by our gifts. Accept what we offer as signs of our humble gratitude for all that you do on our behalf. Make us servants of Christ in bringing your sons and daughters to a greater sense of glory. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.